Okay. Now, the next section of the talk is we can extend Spark API. So Spark gives lot of nice operators for you to work with, map, flat map, compare to Hadoop, but sometimes it's not enough for us. And if the way we do Spark API extension is not by changing the source code. But if it is a source code change, then we will not do a session. It's a long discussion. But there are a few nice tricks we can use with the information what we discussed in the earlier section, how to extend Spark API. So this is a topic, and I'll cover very few things in here because there are so many things to cover, but we'll only cover a few things. So just to give an idea how easy it is. Okay, let's start. First question is why? What is the motivation? One of the things is Spark gives a lot of operators, map, flat map, those kind of things. But they are not domain specific. Right? So if you are a domain guy and if you say map, flat map, you do not give any idea what's going on. So we want to create domain specific operators. Right? That's the first motivation. The same thing is once you have a domain specific operator, it improves the code readability. Because I understand what's going on rather than saying some combination of map, flat map, and reduced by key. It kind of don't give you any idea that what's going on. You have to dig into the code and say, okay, now I understand what's going on. Third thing is that if it is readable, it's easy to maintain. The second thing is that till now we've seen the flat map RDD, map RDD, those kind of things. But can we create domain RDDs? The name itself should say what RDD transformation you are doing. We can do that. So that's the second part, where we can say we create our own specific RDDs, where we give name like discount RDD or whatever the RDD, where we say, oh, this discount RDD means an RDD which has discount, rather than saying just mapped RDD. Again, once I have created my own RDD, I can have my own chain of dependencies and those kind of things. So two things we are going to see. One, domain-specific operator. Another, domain-specific RDDs. So these are the two things we are going to look at. Now, one example I will give you. Let us say I have a sales record RDD, which is of the type RDD sales record. This sales record, you can think like a domain specific class. Like how we have in ORM, we have a domain class, right? Same way, I can create a domain class, and this RDD is just collection of those sales record. Now, what I want to say is that in the sales, I want to say total sales, right? How many are done for this time? Now, if I say how to do in plain Spark, I take the RDD and I map which field has that actual value, and then I do a sum. Are you able to follow? This is plain Spark. What I do, I take my record, then I take which field has that actual value, then I do a sum. But thing is that, if you are a person who not seen Spark before, that do not give you any kind of idea what may be going on, unless you not seen map anything. Can we write like this? Sales record dot total sales. Are you able to follow what I'm trying to say? And if you look at this, it feels like it is built into Spark. It's not like total sales of RDD, no. It's on RDD, I am having an operator which is specific to the domain. Are you able to follow? Now what happens? Suddenly the readability and maintainability will be more. Because I know, okay, total sales. I don't care, do you do map or reduce or something internally. I say, okay, take an RDD, I'll do total sales. And what you can do is that you can build a library of operators which is specific for your domain. Okay, so that is the thing. And our DSL has internal representation, because if you do here, if the sales record changes, this will not change, right? Here, if the item value change into item sum or something, then this name has to change. But if you say total sales, only library has to update the domain. In the use case of the user, they say, okay, we always say total sales. Which column, how to read, all those things are given to the library person. All are able to follow? But it has to feel like built in, not like something we are layering on top of it. That's the idea. Now, the question is how to extend. You have to come back. Okay. We'll come back to this slide later. And go next. Yeah. The way we do is we do like implicits. So how to extend a data type in Java? So if let us say I have a data type like a person, I want to add a few more function to it. What do? We do inheritance. Correct. Now with the inheritance, problem is the maintenance. Right? So with the inheritance, all the things will come. And wherever you are calling, now you have to have this interface idea. Right? give this interface, internally you figure out which is a subclass and then call those kind of things. And sometimes there may be classes which are final, where you cannot do the extend. So in Scala, there is a different way of doing extending. So that are called as implicits. What is implicit? It is a way of extending the type on the fly. So which means you don't extend from the type, but you can add new features to the types on the fly. So what is on the fly means? It's a compile time only. It's not a runtime. But on the fly means you don't change the source code or you don't extend from the thing. By writing some way of code, it will automatically add new features to that type. Okay? The second thing is that implicits also used in other places, but we are not going to look at. We only going to look at for the types. Implicit can be used like a default parameters in the methods. So in the methods, if I say take from the environment where this should be, then you can also use the implicits. And this is important. All implicits are done at compile time so that there is no penalty you have to give in the runtime. So all the transformation, everything is done in the compile time. And one more thing also is implicits are lexically bounded. They are not like a global object. So if you import and want to use it, then only you will get those features. If not, then you will not get. Because sometimes what happens is that when you add dynamically these things, when you go to the source code and say, oh, where is that method? I am accessing that method, but in the source code is not there because it's coming from somewhere. To avoid that problem, that global problem, what we do is that we bound them in the lexical, which means if I import, then I know, oh, I imported something, maybe it should be coming from there. And implicits are very powerful. Spark itself uses implicit in a lot of places. And in this, we are going to show you one example in Scala, how to use implicits. Then, using that, how to do in the Spark also. Okay, and this is only for Scala API of Spark. If you are using Python and I think Python is easy. There is some way of monkey patching, like you can dynamically add a thing. I'm not sure about how you do in Java, so it may not be there in Java. Okay, now if you compare to the earlier slide, so what we do is that we add the custom operators to RDD using the implicit mechanism, which means there is no mechanism itself in the Spark to do it. We use the Scala mechanism in order to add the new operators to the RDD. So what we do is that, go to next slide. First we'll see the implicit example in Scala, then we'll see how to do it in the Spark. So how many of you are using Scala? So last time few people. Okay, let us see that example. Implicit example, yeah. Alright. Now, I have a normal, so let us look at the main method. I have a normal int, 10. Int do not have a function called square, normally, right? But I want to add a function to the int which does a squaring of the number. Okay, but I cannot say my int extends int, because everywhere where you are using int, now I have to use my int. That's the problem. Now what I do is this trick. The first thing I have to do is I define a wrapper class which is going to add new functions. So this is a kind of a wrapper class which takes the base type, that's the int, and it says add a new method called square value to value. So this is the wrapper class says what are the new methods I want to add to this type. Then someone has to do the conversion, right? From the normal into the custom. That's where we use implicit. We say implicit define add custom function, and this is the way to write. What it says is whenever you import this custom functions, this is a kind of we can import, then you convert all the ints which are in the lexical scope into custom int functions. Which means automatically what are the functions you have defined in that class will be available on that data type. And again, very, very specific here, this is only available to the data types which you declare. This is not a global function which is available on everywhere. This is the function available for the integers only. So these are type bounded, which means which type you want to add a new functionality. Are you able to follow what I'm trying to say? Then finally, I have to import specifically that custom int function dot underscore means import everything, all the functions. Then I can say, normal int dot square. Now one of the way to say is it implicit is normally IntelliJ puts a underscore kind of underline here. This underline normally gives a idea that it is not from the source, it is from the implicits. Okay, just to give you a hint. Now also I have commented some code. It says that if you have a float number, then you are not get the square, because we told it has to be on the integer. If you want, you can add another implicit which for a float. By default here, we cannot add it for that. So it is lexically bounded and is bounded by the time. So idea in the Scala is you can extend even the built-in functionalities by adding your own implicits, but not changing the code. This is very similar to JavaScript. In JavaScript, there is something called a prototype, right? Where you can add a new function and it will be automatically there on the type. Only problem with the JavaScript, it is global, right? Here it is not global. It is always lexically bounded. Lexically bounded means only this section of the code will going to have access to those. But if you see, I can do the square. So there is three sections. First section is a class which says, which are the new methods I want to add. Then there is one implicit method which says how to convert from the normal to the specific ones, and once you import and you can use it. Make sense? All are able to follow? Now let us see the example of RDD. Now I know how to do. Let us see one from Spark.
Here only.
Here instead of int, you can be another class. Yeah, you can take any other class also. So we'll see. That's what we do in the Spark. Custom operator example. Now, if you go out, I have an RDD of sales record. Just say, click on this and say Control V. Just see what is the sales record looks like. Enter. So, sales record is just a class, which is a domain class which having all the fields. So, rather than using the text, I am passing the text and creating a domain class. Then, if I go back to my custom operator, okay, I am saying add these two functions to the type of RDD of sales record. See, I am very specifically saying add this function to RDD of sales record, not to all the RDDs. The reason is that I need this only for my domain RDDs, not for something like all the RDDs, because then it will lead to wrong errors, right? So I am very specific. And what I want to add? I want to add a total sales, which internally is implemented using Spark API only. Here I am not doing anything more complex, but I am saying I want to have a new function on the RDD. Then again, there is an implicit which says whenever there is a RDD of sales record, add these custom functions. Then if you come down, okay, these are the methods, just a passing logic. Then I can say import custom function. I can say sales record RDD dot total sales. And can you see that underlining? Now what happened here is that now suddenly my RDD has a new operator called total sales, which feels and looks like a built-in function. Correct? Can you see here? So this is very powerful, which means you can create a library of operators and can tell to your developers that okay, you can use this, and they cannot make a mistake because you are bounded by the type. You can only call this an RDD of sales record. You cannot call on any other RDD, and also they have to import specifically. If they don't import, then I will get an error saying that this method is not available.
So this is very specific
to
Scala.
Yeah, so this is very specific to Scala. This is not Spark part. So using Scala, the reason I am showing this one is, if you know, there is something called pair RDD functions. You get this reduce by key, all those kind of things. Internally, Spark use implicits for that. So they don't have a separate RDD functions. What they do, they when you say spark context dot underscore, those pair RDD functions will be came as implicits. So internally they use implicits, but that's for Scala. For Python and Java, they do separately. The implementation is different. Yeah. So implicits is a Scala feature. So it's not a Spark feature. So you can write an implicit in the Scala, then you can use it in the Java. But I am not sure can you write the implicits itself in Java, because Java do not have those functionality. Because what Spark does is that implementation is there in the Scala, but when you use from the Java, you can use it, but you may not be able to write it.
Correct. Number 10 you imported and you got this extra feature.
No, then you have to create a new block. That's flower bracket, open bracket, but normally the lexical scope goes through, right? You have to go to a new function. So lexical scope means if you are imported in the top, all the functions, all the code inside that function has to have it. There's no
one. Like imported inside a function.
So then it's only for function. Yeah.
Okay.
So if it's inside a function, then it's, so it's a functional scoping, right? If it's there inside a function, then it's therefore. But if you are importing in like a top, and if there is a multiple function inside, then they will have the access to that. Okay, so one thing I have to say about implicits is use them very carefully, because implicits are normally the kind of bug where you are confused that where it is coming from. So they are normally the kind of feature which makes you confused. Because you go to the source code and say, RDD don't have total cells, where it is coming from. Right, so use them very carefully, right, where you need it, and make them explicit, like make them import explicit. Don't. So the reason why I'm not putting import custom function in the top, then it will be everywhere, and then we'll say, okay, which import it is. That's why I am putting import near to the where I'm using, so that I know, okay, it is coming from here. And if you really want to be specific, no need to say underscore, because underscore means everything inside that custom function. You can say custom functions dot total cells, then only you will import that thing. But this is the standard, like if you see Scala code, underscores are everywhere. So underscore means give me everything, I'll figure out what to use. But you can be very careful also. So what we have done here is that by using the idea of implicits, we have added the operator which can do domain specific things. Now you can ask me, can we do something actions? You can, because we know run job API is there. I can run some run job and give some those types. So, and inside the implementation of that method, you can run the run job. So you can do transformations if you want, or you can even do the actions using the run job API. So what is the idea? We added a custom operator to a domain specific RDD, which allows me to do use like a built-in Spark API rather than having a separate way of doing the things. Make sense? Are you able to follow? So this is the first part I wanted to show you. Let us go back to the slides. And I'm also knowing that this is not going to be easy to digest beginning if you have not seen the implicits, but I just wanted to show you what is there out there. You can go back and use it. Okay, next. Custom operator we have already seen. The next thing is that we want to extend RDDs sometimes. Like I'm not happy with map and flat map. I want to create my own thing. So that is the second thing. And also when we extend RDD, I can show you that compute function. So we have talked about this compute function, right? So I will show you that how the compute function looks like. So what we want to do is that we want to create a discount RDD. What may be a discount RDD? It calculates discounts, right? So let us see how to do that. Okay, open the discount RDD. Open the discount RDD. Yeah. Now if you see discount RDD, here we are saying previous. Previous means which RDD it is coming from. That's a previous. Then this discount percentage is specific. I want to give a discount on this percentage. And if you see, it extends RDD of sales record. The reason is that discount can be only given on sales. You cannot give a discount on any RDD. So I am very specific here. Then I am overriding this compute. Compute has two parameters. You get the access to the partition, then you get the access to the task context. Actually, task context has this configurations. So if you used a MapReduce API, there is a context, right, where we write to a context in MapReduce. Similar idea here. Now, what I'm doing here is that, if you see here, when I do my map function, where I have to do the discount, I always say first parent dot iterator. Are you able to see? I am going to call iterator on my parent, then whatever the output I get, I am going to do some mapping. Are you able to follow what I am trying to say? This shows you that chain part, which means before I do the discount, I have to say, okay, you have to give me the sales data. How I can say? I say, take the parent. I am here hard coding kind of, I know it's only one parent. I am saying, give me the parent, do the iteration on it, whatever the output I get, I am going to do some action. So here what I am doing, I am doing just a map and doing some calculations, but here I am kind of showing you that how this chain works. Are you able to follow what I am trying to say? And also, see here get partitions. Now get partitions allows you to repartition if you want. In your RDD you can repartition if you want, but what I am trying to say here is that I am just having the partition same as the parent. I don't want to change the partitions of the partitions here. Whatever the partitions you had for the parent, just I am going to give that. But if you want, in this API, you can repartition if you want. So this gives you a kind of control over how you want this RDD to structure in the, and also how to do the distribution. So two things you have to override. You have to override compute, and you have to override the get partitions. Compute says what functionality you want to do. Get partition says, do you want to change the partitions? If you don't want, you can just say, use the parents one. If you want, you can change the partitions. Yeah. Are you able to follow? How to use it? We use the same trick of implicits. RDD examples. I create a new thing called discom. But you see, as I told you that transformation, I'm creating a new RDD. Right? I'm creating a new instance of a subclass of RDD, where say, when you do discom, don't run anything, just create a subclass, which means this is lazy. Are you able to follow? My earlier operator ran actually some value and it gave you my sum, but here I'm saying don't run anything, do a new subclass. So which means when I call discom, I get an RDD of the type discount RDD. Are you able to follow? Which means we are creating our own domain specific RDDs also. It's not like map RDD or flat map RDD. This is very specific called discount RDDs. Make sense? Okay, so how to use it? Simple, just flip it down. Discount RDD, take the sales record and say discount. Again, this is using implicits. And once you have a discount, then you can do whatever the normal RDD functions. You can collect all those kind of. But you have to remember, when I say discount, it's a lazy. The reason is that I have specified it's a new subclass which does the computation only when you are asked for it. So, two ways. You can add an operator which can do some manipulation and actions. You can also create your own RDD where it gives, first of all, your own domain specific names. If I print discount RDD, I know, rather than some generic mapped RDD. And also it allows you to have a control over computation, also control over what is the distribution you want through the partition. Make sense? So the combination of implicit operators and the custom RDDs allows you to extend the Spark API and make and feel like built-in rather than having a completely new set of the thing. And what most of the people do actually use the same functionality. For example, if you use Spark with Cassandra, what they do, they write the implicits and say RDD.save to Cassandra. Right? The library gives that functionality. The reason is that then it feels like a built-in RDD function rather than coming from the somewhere else. So all these new functionalities which people want to plug into Spark, they normally go through the implicits. So that's why it's good to know if you how to use the implicits. Are you able to follow kind of a thing? All right, so this kind of a completes our discussion on Spark advanced topics, right? So we looked at first part is anatomy, which means what happens when I actually take RDD and do the transformation. Next part is what is the advantage of knowledge? The advantage of knowledge is that I can extend the Spark API to the way I need to. That is specific to my domains. Okay, all are able to follow. I'm not sure how much actually digested. It takes some time, but code is out there, and even I'm going to share the PPT. And if you have any questions, you can ask me now. But also I have to maybe check and see, like, because last time there was a food. I'm not sure this time. But I'll check with and be here, because if the food is there, we don't want to waste it. If it's not there, then you have to go out and eat, right? But before that, any questions? First of all are able to follow what's gone on like for last, I think 3 hours, right? And all are okay with this kind of sessions? Like this is like not normal sessions, right? These are advanced sessions, and that's the reason why we want to do a longer sessions. So it's not like a 20 minutes, 30 minutes. We cannot cover these kind of things. And also we want to continue kind of stuff. So people who already seen the video or kind of know RDDs, this kind of a next step to them. Makes sense what I'm trying to say? So, okay, with the faces, I'm thinking that, okay, something's gone in. And I'm hoping that we can do this kind of session more. Because there I want to do few other sessions also, and also some other people, a little bit more deeper, right? Maybe the caching or some other parts. Okay, no questions? All are fine? Okay, so I'll just stop the recording.